Good afternoon, everyone. iTech India welcomes all the participants for today's National Distance Learning Seminar. Today's topic is HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders, and the speaker is Dr. Priya Patil. Dr. Priya Patil is currently working as Deputy Director, COE, JJ Hospital, and Alternate Nodal Officer for both the ART centers at JJ Hospital. She is an Associate Professor of Medicine in Grand Government Medical College and Sir JJ Group of Hospitals, Baikala, Mumbai. She has done her MBBS and MD from BJMC Pune. She has done many thesis studies on HIV, out of which 4 are published. She has done study at ICMR on OI profile in HIV. We welcome you, ma'am, for today's session.
Good afternoon, everybody. I thank iTech for giving me opportunity to take this lecture. And before I begin my lecture, I want to congratulate each and every person of every ART in our country, so that everybody is coming and sincerely doing their duties in spite of this ongoing pandemic of COVID. So I'm saluting all the medical officers and all the ART teams. Now coming to this lecture topic of today, the objectives. So we are going to discuss about HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders. So before that, we will see how HIV affects the CNS. There are numerous ways that HIV has a major impact on the CNS. Then we will see the definition of HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders. The short form will be referred to as HAND, H-A-N-D. Then risk factors for HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders. What is the neuropathogenesis of these spectrum of neurocognitive disorders? Then assessment and diagnosis of H-A-N-D, treatment of H-A-N-D, and an important aspect of CNS penetration of ART drugs, and then the summary. So how does HIV affect the nervous system? We can see the picture which shows the depicts the blood-brain barrier. There are blood vessels in the CNS, and then there is the endothelium, and then there is a endothelial covering, which is the blood-brain barrier, and then there are the different cells, the neurons and fibrous astrocytes, which are there in the CNS. So HIV easily crosses the blood-brain barrier, and that's how it is going to impact the CNS very early on in the infection. So as HIV enters the CNS at a very early stage of infection, a cascade of events leads to changes in multiple realms of cognition. Now, HIV indirectly destroys cells in the nervous system. We can see here that HIV infects the microglia, which are the macrophages in the CNS system. And then these microglia, which are infected with HIV, they will release neurotoxins. And these neurotoxins then affect the neurons. And these neurons can have apoptosis or they can undergo neurotoxicity. Again, the shed viral proteins like GP120, they will bind the microglia. And this leads to release of neurotoxins from these cells. And again, these neurotoxins will impact the neurons and also the astrocytes in the CNS. Coming to HIV and cognitive impairment. Now, cognitive complaints are common in HIV. Acute delirium secondary to legion of metabolic and infectious complications. So HIV has a wide spectrum by how it affects the CNS. So there can be many metabolic complications, there can be infectious complications like an array of opportunistic infections. So that will be seen shortly. Then HIV associated neurocognitive disorders, on which we are going to today focus on. So these are directly related to the presence of the virus in the CNS. Then there are other chronic cognitive impairments not directly related to HIV, like for example alcohol, which is common in the setting of HIV, and or other drugs, again to mention hepatitis C and vascular impairments. Then age-related neurodegenerative diseases. Now because of ART, effective ART, PLHIV are living longer lives, and so again there is an early aging, and so these age-related neurodegenerative diseases are also important as a causative mechanism for cognitive complaints in HIV. Then cognitive symptoms associated with psychiatric illness. Again, this is important, and psychiatric illnesses like depression, they can cause a lot of cognitive symptoms. Now coming to how does HIV affect the CNS, nervous system? The most important thing which we should consider is general immunosuppression, which can lead to CNS opportunistic infections. Now, as we know, there are an array of CNS opportunistic infections, and many times NDLS has been conducted regarding what are the different OIs in HIV in CNS. To name a few, we have fungal cryptococcal meningitis, then we have CNS toxoplasmosis, we have viral affection of CNS like the JC virus causing progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Then you have TB, most important mycobacterial infection, so TB meningitis or tuberculoma. So all these opportunistic infections can cause the neurocognitive deficits in a PLHIV. Again, there are many HIV related tumors like HIV lymphoma, primary CNS lymphoma or secondaries, and then these also can affect the CNS. Now, how does HIV affect the nervous system as a whole? Primary HIV disease, so HIV per se, can lead to HIV associated dementia when it infects the brain. Vacuolar myelopathy, because of the spinal cord affection. Peripheral neuropathy, it is a nerve affection. And aseptic meningitis, acute as well as chronic. So coming to HIV affection per se of the nervous system, 10 to 15% of acquired immunodeficiency syndrome patients present with neurologic symptoms only. 35 to 50% of AIDS patients have neurologic symptoms during life, and as high as 75 to 90% have neuropathologic abnormalities at death. Now coming to the concept of HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders. Now, changes in memory, concentration, and motor skills are common in PLHIV. So these are diagnostic challenges to the clinicians. When not clearly attributable to alternate cause other than HIV infection. We saw a lot of alternate causes like OIs, we saw tumors, we saw neurodegenerative disorders, vascular disorders. So when they are not clearly attributable to such alternative causes other than HIV infection, such impairments have been collectively classified as HIV associated neurocognitive disorders. So coming to the definition of HIV associated neurocognitive disorders, the Frascati criteria. So these are widely accepted criteria now. Now neurocognitive deficits in PLHIV due to HIV infection per se and not because of any alternative cause. These are classified in three levels based on the impaired neuropsychological test performance and functional impairment. So we have three types here, or the three levels: asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment, mild neurocognitive disorder, and HIV-associated dementia. So HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders, HAND, is an umbrella terminology for this spectrum ranging from asymptomatic to severe. Now, such a classification is helpful in diagnosis and categorization for research and clinical purposes. Coming to the definitions, asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment, or ANI, it is defined by a score of one standard deviation or more below the mean in at least two cognitive domains on standardized neuropsychological testing without a symptomatic or observable functional impairment. Now, basically in any assessment of neurocognitive disorder, whenever we are performing, I'm going to discuss shortly what are the different neuropsychological testings and the domains. But we should remember that a standard deviation of 0.5 or half is significant in any such when we are assessing the neuropsychological testing and when we are assessing the cognitive disturbance. So for ANI, a deviation of one standard deviation is definitely a significant finding. So deviation of deviation of the score, that score is obtained on a standard neuropsychological testing. So there are different testings which we'll be discussing. So when that score is one standard deviation below the mean in at least two cognitive domains, then it is asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment. But here the patient is asymptomatic or does not have any functional impairment. Coming to mild neurocognitive disorder, It is defined by a score of 1 standard deviation or more below the mean in at least 2 cognitive domains, again on standardized neuropsychological testing, but with at least mild symptomatic or functional impairment. So here also there is a deviation of 1 standard deviation of 1 in the score, but here there is a mild symptomatic or functional impairment, whereas in the previous it was asymptomatic. And then we have the frank HIV associated dementia. So I think all of you might have seen such cases of HIV associated dementia. So it is defined here by a score of 2 standard deviations or more below the mean in at least 2 cognitive domains on standardized neuropsychological testing with concomitant impairment in activities of daily living. So there is a frank functional impairment seen in a patient of HIV associated dementia, and it is the most severe of the whole spectrum of HAND. HIV associated dementia has been previously referred to as AIDS dementia complex, HIV encephalitis, or HIV encephalopathy. Basically, this is a subacute syndrome of progressive cognitive and motor dysfunction. Now, coming to the various neurocognitive domains, we defined the three levels on the basis of at least 2 domains. So what are the neuropsychological domains used in the neuropsychological testing to classify HAND? So it can be verbal or language function, then attention or concentration. So there are battery of tests which will test each of these domains separately. So different domains are verbal or language, attention or concentration, working memory, executive or abstraction, memory, that is learning or recall, speed of information processing, sensory or perceptual, and motor skills. So the different battery of neuropsychological testing will assess the scores in each of these domains. And when there is a deviation of either 1 standard deviation or 2 standard deviations, then we can classify as the spectrum in the hand, as we just now discussed. Now coming to the most severe form of HIV associated dementia. So this is a classic form. The classic form is primarily characterized by subcortical dysfunction. The other dementias like Alzheimer's, they mainly affect the cortex. So they are known as cortical dementias. Whereas the HIV associated dementia is a subcortical dysfunction. There is a attention or concentration impairment. There can be depressive symptoms. There can be impaired psychomotor speed and precision. The onset is generally subacute, and the deficits may be waxing and waning with time, unlike progressive neurological decline seen in other neurodegenerative diseases like the Alzheimer's disease. Now, the different cognitive defects in HIV-associated dementia, they are substantial memory deficits, impaired executive functioning, poor attention and concentration. Patient is not unable to focus. There can be mental slowing. There can be apathy. The cognitive deficits are evident, and they clearly impair the functional status. The patient is too slow and forgetful to work or prepare meals and can get lost while walking or driving. There can be behavior and mood changes in HIV-associated dementia. So there can be apathy and lack of motivation. Patient can have an irritable mood. There can be lack of sleep, sleeplessness, weight loss may be there. Patient may have restlessness, anxiety, or agitation. The mood changes may sometimes can even progress to psychosis and hallucinations. And however, as against patients of major depression, there is lack of crying spells or sadness in contrast to patients with major depression. So in HIV associated dementia, the overt crying spells or severe sadness is not there. Then the motor symptoms, slowness of movement tested by rapid finger opposition or toe tapping. So there can be slowness in the motor symptoms. Then there can be marked difficulty with smooth limb movements, especially in lower limbs. So patient's gait can be unsteady. So this is a hand classification, HAND classification at a glance. As you can see, in asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment, there is a deviation in the score, mean score, by 1 standard deviation in at least 2 domains, but no functional impairment. Then in mild neurocognitive impairment, there is again a deviation in the score on neuropsychological testing by one standard deviation in at least two domains, but there is a mild functional impairment or patient will be mildly symptomatic. And then we have HIV associated dementia, where there is a two standard deviation deflection in the score in at least two domains, and the functional impairment is moderate to severe. The questions will be addressed at the end of the lecture. So I will just continue, and then at the end we'll take all the questions. Now coming to HAND in the era of ART, highly active antiretroviral treatment. Although incidence of HIV dementia has decreased dramatically, milder forms of cognitive impairment have increased. So ART has definitely had a great impact, and there is a great decrease in the incidence of the HIV associated dementia. But still there are milder forms of cognitive impairment and the incidence has increased. After over 25 years of research, the specific triggers for HIV associated neurocognitive disorders, they remain unknown. Improved survival means that more individuals with HAND must learn to cope with the disabling effects of impaired cognition. Now, prevalence of HAND based on the new criteria. Now, if we do the neuropsychological testing on the whole HIV population, 30 to 60% will have normal scores. Then asymptomatic neurological impairment will be seen in 20 to 30%. Mild neurocognitive impairment will be seen in 20 to 30%. And HIV associated dementia will be seen only in 5 to 20%. So the incidence of HIV associated dementia is much less. However, as high as 20 to 30% will have mild neurocognitive impairment. So the functional impairment is seen in both these categories. Now, why should we screen? Because mild neurocognitive impairment has been associated with poorer health outcomes, possibly due to poorer adherence to medication. So there should be awareness in all our medical officers, in all our ART staff, that there can be cognitive deficits in this PLHIV. And if we properly address these issues, then this can lead to better adherence. Otherwise, if this goes undiagnosed, this leads to poorer adherence to medications. Even mild HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder is associated with worse quality of life, difficulty obtaining employment, and shorter survival. McGuir, Gurkin, and Douglas report that HAND independently predicts systemic morbidity and overall HIV mortality. So we should consider screening upon the initiation of ART and after that every 6 to 12 months. Now, I will be discussing the various screening tools and which screening tool is best applicable at the bedside. So it is not definitely the battery of neuropsychological testing is out of scope. It is not feasible in our ART centers due to heavy patient load and resource limitation, and also because it requires expertise and is very time consuming. But we can do simple bedside tests which can at least screen such patients, and this can help in the diagnosis and prompt referral and proper treatment initiation. Now coming to the risk factors or comorbidities for HIV associated neurocognitive disorders. Risk factors for HIND can be classified as disease factors, treatment factors, and comorbidities. Coming to the disease related demographic factors, risk factors. So low nadir CD4 count. So if the lowest CD4 count was very low, then this is a high risk factor for the development of HIV associated neurocognitive disorder. Then high plasma HIV RNA, high CSF viral load, low current CD4 count, history of past HIV related CNS diseases, a longer HIV duration, older age, female sex, and lower socioeconomic status. So all these are the risk factors for development of neurocognitive disease due to HIV. The treatment related risk factors are low ART adherence, episodes of ART interruption, ART neurotoxicity, and lower CNS penetration efficiency of certain ART drugs. We'll be discussing regarding the penetration efficiency of the ART drugs shortly. the other risk factors and comorbidities. Positive HCV status with high HCV RNA is again a risk factor for HIV dementia. Then history of acute cardiovascular event. Then cardiovascular risk factors like hyperlipidemia, hypertension, chronic diabetes. Again, these are risk factors because these cardiovascular risk factors can lead to vascular disease, like there can be infarction in the CNS and vascular dementia as well. Then anemia and thrombocytopenia, psychiatric disorders, alcohol or drug abuse, Alzheimer's disease, cerebrovascular disease, and vitamin deficiencies. So these are other risk factors and they can worsen a patient who already has HIV associated neurocognitive disorder. Coming to the signs and symptoms, these may change. There are changes over time in the augmentation. There may be new behavior. There may be subtle and these can be very subtle and missed, or the PLHIV thinks it's something else. Now, four domains are mainly affected: memory, motor, concentration, and social. And there are changes in the ability to organize. So coming to memory, the patient may complain of losing keys, losing objects, forgetting appointments, lost in conversations, going to a room but can't remember why, short-term memory not as good as previous, can misplace things, trouble remembering names, words are on tip of tongue, word finding. Then motor skills, there can be impairment in motor skills, so the person may experience tripping, unsteady gait, poorer keyboard skills, clumsy fine hand movement coordination, driving skills may be worsened, difficulty doing up buttons, there may be difficulty in using mobile efficiently, signature and writing skills may change. Then problems in concentration, so trouble following a movie, trouble reading, gets distracted in conversations, difficulty in focusing, can only do one thing at a time, so multitasking is difficult, slower at doing usual things, feel like in a fog. Then there can be changes in social behavior, like patient is apathetic, he's not interested, he may be having lethargy, do not go out as much as previously he was, not engaging with family or friends, withdrawn even if they do go out, not mixing with others, there can be loss of sexual drive, there can be increased irritability, there may be sometimes sexual disinhibition or risk-taking, and increased risk-taking in general. Coming to executive function symptoms, so the organizational ability has changed. For example, ability to follow through or plan a task has deteriorated. The flexibility may change. So the patient has a need to do the task in the same way. He may not be flexible. There can be problem in problem solving. Then mental tasks take longer than in the past. More physically and mentally tired at the end of the day, as they have to concentrate harder than before to get the same things done. So the questions for screening for hand. So how do we screen? So we can have a short questionnaire like, are you slower in your thinking than you? And the answers should be either yes, definitely, or sometimes, hardly sometimes, or never. So these are the three options for the answer. So what can be the questions in the questionnaire? Are you slower in your thinking than you used to be? Are you more forgetful than you used to be? Do you experience frequent memory loss? Is it harder to organize things? Do you feel you are slower when reasoning, planning activities, or solving problems? Do you have difficulties paying attention, example, conversation, a book, or a movie? Are you able to find pleasure in the things you used to enjoy? If the answer is yes, definitely, to three or more questions, then we need to evaluate further. Then the family or friends may be giving some history, so we can ask their family or friends that, are they more forgetful? Has their personality changed? Or are they finding it harder to organize their life? So some history can be even given by the relatives. Now, what is the neuropathogenesis for HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder? So one is sustained CNS inflammation, as we discussed previously, then accelerated vascular disease, and amyloid deposition. Coming to sustained CNS inflammation, as we saw, HIV indirectly destroys cells in the nervous system, though HIV does not infect the neurons per se directly. Indirectly, it will infect the macrophages in the CNS, that is the microglia, and also the shed viral proteins, they also exert a lot of neurotoxicity. And this leads to neuronal injury and apoptosis, leading to dementia. This is a picture showing brain tissue loss in AIDS patients. So the orange panel shows 15% loss, then yellow 10%, and blue, light blue 5%. So we can see that there is a loss, most damage in the brain regions controlling movement in the motor area, then memory and planning. Now this shows the brain deposition of amyloid in the HIV positive patients. So amyloid is increased in diffuse non-neurotic plaques in the PLHIV brains. An increase in diffuse plaques suggests early aging with HIV infection and may be enough to cause cognitive impairment. Coming to the diagnosis and differential diagnosis. Now it is very important to remember that HIV associated neurocognitive disorder is a diagnosis of exclusion. So we have to exclude many other things before we confirm the diagnosis of HAND. And there's a lot of overlap. As you can see, there are many overlap with other medical conditions. So HIV associated neurocognitive disorders may share symptoms with mood disorders, drug and alcohol abuse, mania and psychosis or depression, other infections and neurologic problems, or over-sedation with medications commonly given for sleep, mood problems and other disorders. Coming to depression and anxiety. Depressed mood is one of the most common complaints among people living with HIV. Given the high co-occurrence of HIV and post-traumatic stress disorder, anxiety is also frequently seen. These disorders may present themselves as somatic complaints like headaches, GI complaint, weakness, fatigue, insomnia, chest pain, shortness of breath. The somatic complaints are not unusual in HIV/AIDS even when the patient is mentally healthy. In HIV patients, symptoms of depression overlap with understandable unhappiness, with symptoms of cognitive impairment. So not always the cognitive impairment is because of the HIV associated neurocognitive disorder. It may be in depression masquerading as a neurocognitive impairment. There can be overlap with symptoms of physical illness like fatigue. Now diurnal variation of mood suggests depression. The cornerstone of depression is not only sadness, but the symptoms of anhedonia. So what is anhedonia? It is the inability to experience pleasure from the activities usually found enjoyable. So the patient loses pleasure or happiness from the usual activities like hobbies, music, sexual activities, social interactions, and exercise. So nothing is now enjoyable at present. So that is the symptom. Now, impact of depression on in HIV infection. Depression in HIV people is underdiagnosed and there is a high prevalence. So because it is underdiagnosed, depression in HIV is undertreated. So this leads to poorer outcome of HIV disease, increased health costs and decreased quality of life. So diagnosis of HAND, it is a diagnosis of exclusion. So what should be the approach? History is very important. So history of fever, seizures and acute onset of disease. These will go in favor of any opportunistic infection. So whenever such a history of fever, convulsions, headache and acute onset, then we must do a proper evaluation to rule out any CNS opportunistic infection. Neurological examination, it is important. If there is a focal neurological deficit, like there is a hemiplegia, there is a craniometaphyseal palsy, there is a upgoing extensor plantar, then this suggests other diagnosis. This cannot be HIV associated neurocognitive disorder. Though the presentation may be with cognitive impairment, the cause may be underlying infection. Then psychiatry assessment is very essential and necessary to rule out depression, anxiety and substance abuse. Lab studies are very important. B12 deficiency is an important cause of memory loss, and it is B12 deficiency is very, very common in our country. In vegetarian patients with vegetarian diet. Again, PLHIV, they have B12 deficiency very commonly because of sometimes malabsorption, HIV, diarrhea, etc. So B12 deficiency must be ruled out. Endocrine and metabolic encephalopathy must be ruled out. For example, thyroid function test screening is very important. So like any other dementia approach, we have to do all these tests. Metabolic encephalopathy, so doing a liver function test, serum creatinine, all these tests are very, very important. We should exclude all other causes before we think of HAND. So diagnosis of HAND, we rule out CNS opportunistic infection. So CT brain or MRI brain to rule out granulomas like toxoplasma, tuberculoma, and progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, it is important. Brain imaging is also important to rule out cerebral hemorrhage or infarction or multi-infarct dementia. Imaging can also diagnose CNS tumors like lymphoma. CSF analysis is important to rule out OIs like TB meningitis, cryptococcal meningitis. And it is also important to assess for immunological failure and virological failure. Now, CNS imaging and diagnosis of HIV-associated dementia. Cerebral atrophy is typically evident in HIV-associated dementia. So there is a cortical atrophy. It affects mainly the basal ganglia, particularly the caudate lobe and white matter, but also cortical regions. There is enlargement of ventricles, and the cortical sulci may occur early in the disease course. So enlargement of ventricles and cortical sulci, this can occur early in the disease course. On MRI, T2-weighted images show diffuse or patchy white matter hyperintensity, but this is a non-specific finding. Space-occupying lesions and focal contrast enhancement are incompatible with the diagnosis of HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder. The main use of brain imaging is, however, the exclusion of diseases mimicking HAND. So here is a MRI, typical imaging MRI of the brain from a patient with HIV-associated dementia. So bilateral symmetrical high T2 signals without mass effect are present in the white matter of both frontal lobes. We can see the T2 enhanced white matter enhancement in the frontal lobes associated with subcortical atrophy. Now coming to the assessment of a patient with suspected HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder. So there can be behavioral observations. It is acquired abnormality. There can be change in normal activities of daily living and change in the mood or normal social relationships. And then we have to assess the neuropsychological, that is the cognitive test need to be performed. So what are the screening tools? So there are numerous screening tools. Some of them I have named over here. HIV dementia scale, which was described in 1995. Then this was improved as the International HIV dementia scale in 2005. Then we'll be discussing about this Montreal Cognitive Assessment, MOCA test. Now this Montreal Cognitive Assessment test is the most practical bedside screening tool for assessment of patients because it is an office procedure. Anybody, it is very simple to perform and it can be done in 10 minutes. So it's not time consuming. So it is a screening tool. Of course, neuropsychological testing, which is formal neuropsychological testing, is done by experts with the help of neurologists. So that mean that is more time consuming and that is required in research settings or for diagnosis of asymptomatic neurocognitive impairment. Then instrumental activities of daily living scale. So that scales are also important in the assessment. So this is a, sorry for the busy slide, but what I just want to see, you can see there are numerous screening tools for assessment of dementia, out of which we mentioned HIV dementia scale and a modified HIV dementia scale. Now, these have limitations that they detect only severe disease. So mild disease cannot be assessed by the help of these scales. So International HIV dementia scale, I'll be discussing briefly. Then to mention about this mini mental state exam. This mini mental state exam is a standard test, bedside test, which is performed by all clinicians to assess for dementia, and it can be used in Alzheimer's disease diagnosis. However, this is not recommended for diagnosis of HIV-related impairment, HIV-associated dementia. It is insensitive. So mini mental state examination has no role in the diagnosis of HIV associated neurocognitive disorders. Then we'll be discussing about neuropsychological testing, all the batteries, which are tailored set of tests that can test broad set of broad areas of cognitive domains, and they could lead to comprehensive assessment of function and most sensitive to cognitive impairment. Montreal Cognitive Assessment, MoCA, I just mentioned that it is a reasonable choice and it takes only 10 minutes. Now you can see in neuropsychological testing, the time required is 1 to 4 hours. So definitely they are more cumbersome and they are not used in the, they are more in the used in the research settings. Now coming to the International HIV Dementia Scale. So this I have just put here to so that you can get an idea how the different scores are obtained and what are the different aspects of cognition that are tested. So this will have a memory registration test. So give 4 words to recall, like dog, hat, bean, red, and 1 second to say each. Then ask the patient all 4 words after you have said them. Repeat words if the patient does not recall them all immediately. Tell the patient you will ask for recall of the words again a bit later. That is for memory registration. Then you have motor speed. Have the patient tap the first 2 fingers of the non-dominant hand as widely and as quickly as possible. And then depending on how quickly he does, there is a score. 4 for 15 in 5 seconds, 3 for 11 to 14 in 5 seconds, and so on. Then for psychomotor speed, have the patient perform the following movements with the non-dominant hand as quickly as possible. So he performs some movements like clench hand in the fist on flat surface, put the hand flat on surface with palm down, and then put hand perpendicular to the flat surface on the side of the fifth digit, and demonstrate and have the patient perform twice for practice, and then he does this sequentially. And then the score is calculated depending on how well he is able to perform. So this is the psychomotor speed. And then the memory recall. So we had given the patients the 4 words, and then we again ask after some time for him to recall. And so there are the points depending on the score, and there is a total maximum score possible is 12 points. A patient with a score of less than 10 should be evaluated further for possible dementia. Now this is the Montreal Cognitive Assessment Test. So this is at a glance, this test, you can see that it tests the visuospatial or executive function, then naming, memory, attention, language, abstraction, delayed recall, and orientation. So just one by one, we'll quickly see. This is a very simple and basic test you can perform very easily and in 10 minutes. So this is a trail test. So patient has to join in sequence a number and a letter. So first one, followed by A, followed by 2, then B, then 3, then C, and so on. So alternately, one number and one letter in a sequence. Then the patient will be told to copy some image, like a copy a cube. And for executive functioning, the patient is asked to draw a clock. So we can also tell him to draw the timing, 10 past 11. So that is the visuospatial and executive testing. And there are points for that. Then naming test. So you can have pictures of some animals and then ask the patient to name them. Then for memory, again, just like in the previous test, you have to give 4 words, and these words should be familiar, and then tell the patient to again recall after 5 minutes all the 4 words. And depending on how much they recall, there are points. Then attention, read list of digits. So forward list reading, backward reading, read list of letters, and then the subject must tap with his hand at each letter A. Then serial 7 subtraction starting at 100. So 100 minus 7, then 93 minus 7, 86 minus 7, and so on. For language, we have to give a sentence and tell the patient to repeat that sentence. Then abstraction, similarity between banana and orange, it is a fruit, similarity between train and bicycle, and so on. Delayed recall, after that we have to give those, tell the patient to again remember all the 4 words we gave. And then orientation is tested by what date, what month, year, day, place, city. And then the scores are calculated. So normal, the normal score is more than 26 out of 30. add 1 point if the education is less than 12th standard and total score is against 30. So if there is a decreased score, then there is a risk of dementia or the patient has dementia. So this is a the Montreal assessment is a very simple and bedside tool for screening for patients of HIV associated neurocognitive impairment. Now coming to formal neuropsychological assessment of HIV dementia. Now this neuropsychological evaluation is done by experts and it involves comprehensive battery of tests. So these battery of tests identify specific patterns of cognitive impairment that are associated with HIV dementia. They potentially identify different subtypes of HIV dementia. They track the progression of cognitive changes typically seen in HIV dementia. However, skilled professionals are required to do this neuropsychological evaluation. Now, core cognitive impairments are cognitive and motor slowing. So there are reaction time tests, motor measures, then poor divided attention or executive skills, so trail making test, Stroop color interference, and memory. Memory is affected in the later stages. So step one is the neuropsychological performance and step two is the functional impairment. So how to assess the functional impairment? There is collateral informant and objective ratings. These are most reliable. The IADL scale and the driving performance, and then there is the Karnofsky scale. So activities of daily living scale. So it involves assessment in communication, shopping, food preparation, housekeeping, clothing and appearance, medications, medical issues, money, social interaction. So these are the various spectrums. So this is the Lawton instrumental activities of daily living scale. So you can see the different abilities in the daily living and then the scores based on that. For example, ability to use telephone. So whether he can operate the telephone on own, whether he can only dial some few numbers, whether he can answer a telephone but does not dial or does not use telephone at all. Similarly, shopping, whether he's doing shopping independently or completely unable. Food preparation or meal preparation, whether he plans, prepares and serves adequate meals independently, or whether there is a spectrum where he needs to have meals prepared and served, so he is not able to do anything. Housekeeping, whether he's maintaining the house alone or requires assistance, how much assistance is requiring. So all that level is in detail assessed. Needs help with home maintenance tasks or does not participate in any housekeeping tasks. Similarly, modes of transportation, whether he's traveling independently on public transportation or he requires assistance always or does not travel at all. Laundry, responsibility for own medications, whether he's responsible for taking medication in correct dosages at correct time or is not capable of dispensing own medication and somebody has to administer. Then ability to handle finances, that is managing financial matters independently or just manages day-to-day purchases but needs help with banking, major purchases, etc. or totally incapable of handling money. So the scoring for each category, the circle the item description that most closely resemble the client's highest functional level, either 0 or 1. So coming to after assessment and diagnosis, the medical treatment. So we saw that diagnosis of HAND was based on the history, ruling out other alternative causes like infections, ruling out vascular causes, other ruling out psychiatric illnesses, the imaging suggestive of cortical atrophy and in the MRI showing subcortical white matter changes, then the neuropsychological assessments or the dementia scales like Montreal assessment scale, which shows much low scores or scores less than 2 standard deviation. And then there is a marked functional impairment, and we can assess that functional impairment also depending on the functional impairment assessment just now we saw. So once the diagnosis of HIV associated dementia is done, now we have to see what are the treatments for HIV dementia. So does ART penetrate the blood-brain barrier? Now many types of ART do not easily cross into the brain in laboratory studies. However, HIV infected individuals may show increased permeability of the blood-brain barrier. Now coming to medical treatments for HIV dementia, highly active antiretroviral treatment usually reduces viral load both in the periphery and in the CNS. Reduction of viral load in the CNS is associated with reduced cognitive symptoms. So prompt ART initiation is essential for patients who, for a patient who is not on ART. If the patient is already on ART, then virological failure should be ruled out by viral load testing, and CD4 count also should be checked, because as we know, a CD4 less than 200 is a risk factor for HIV dementia. Individuals with stable viral load do not show increased risk for cognitive decline even after 5 years of monitoring. So those who have a stable suppressed viral load, they have much less risk for cognitive decline. Now, mild neurocognitive disorder management, antiretroviral therapy that better distributes into the CNS leads to better outcomes. So even if the patient has a mild cognitive impairment, then we need to see that we can administer drugs which better penetrate the CSF. We are going to see which are the drugs. Comorbid risk factors can be minimized, and physical exercise and mental stimulation are important. Now, this is a very important table which shows the CPE, that is the CSF penetrability effectiveness, the central nervous system penetration effectiveness ranking of antiretroviral agents. So different agents have a different ability to penetrate into the CSF. So coming to the drug class of NRTI, you can see that the CPE score will tell us the ability, how efficiently the drug will penetrate. So CPE score of 1 indicates poor penetration, and 4 indicates very good penetration. Now coming to NRTI, tenofovir has the lowest score, tenofovir and diidonacin. So poor scores are seen in tenofovir and for lamivudine, cimetidine, whereas better scores are seen for 3 for abacavir, and the best score is for zidovudine 4. Then integrase inhibitors, raltegravir has a score of 3 and dolutegravir has a best score of 4. So it is very good that now we are going to switch our first line regimen to dolutegravir, which has a robust CSF penetration. Then coming to PIs, saquinavir, ritonavir has very poor penetration score. Then what we are using in the program, atazanavir, ritonavir has a low CP score of 2, whereas boosted darunavir as well as lopinavir boosted, they have better CSF penetration score. So if a patient who has mild neurocognitive impairment, then it is better to change the regimen. If the patient is on, say, tenofovir TL with ATVR, then better to change the regimen to better drugs like lopinavir, ritonavir, or if we can give zidovudine if there is a sensitivity to these drugs, then or dolutegravir. NNRTI, efavirenz has a score of 3, whereas nevirapine has a better penetration score of 4. And for entry or fusion inhibitors, maraviroc has a score of 3. A CP score of 4 indicates that best penetration into the CNS. Now, importance of ART in treatment. The notion of importance of suppressing the CNS viral replication is supported by a case series that describe patients with long-standing suppression of the plasma viral load but detectable viral replication in the CSF. So there are patients, rare patients, this is not common phenomenon, which is known as the CSF viral escape syndrome. So these patients have just a compartmentalized resistance with the viral resistance is seen only in the CSF compartment. There is viral suppression, plasma viral suppression is seen, but if the CSF viral load is done, it is high, and the resistance pattern shown that the virus in the CSF is resistant. But such a viral escape syndrome is rare and it is not at all common. Again, the facility for doing CSF viral load and CSF viral resistance testing is not available widely, and so this can be difficult to diagnose. However, if a patient who has no other cause found and is having HIV associated dementia, but his viral load is suppressed, he has a very good CD4 count, and no other cause is explained, then we may do this CSF viral load testing and CSF resistance, CSF testing for viral resistance. So these subjects had clinically overt neurological disease and the optimization of their ART according to the CP score and resistance testing all improved clinically in terms of CSF viral load. So there have been such case reports and such patients have been described in numerous studies. So we should remember this, that if a patient has very good CD4 count and suppressed viral load, however, he's having HIV-associated dementia, then we should rule out the viral escape syndrome. So coming to the summary, awareness regarding neurocognitive deficits in PL-HIV is very important so that proper diagnostic evaluation is done and the patient is treated properly. HIV-associated dementia is a subcortical type of cognitive disease with psychomotor slowing as the most salient feature. The differentiation from other types of cognitive disorders becomes even more important, like we should rule out opportunistic infections and psychiatric illnesses like depression. Diagnosis of HIV-associated dementia is made on clinical grounds. Ancillary diagnostic steps are done to exclude differential diagnosis. For treatment of HIV-associated neurocognitive disorders, CNS penetrating substances should be considered. So the references are as mentioned over here. There are some articles taken from the journals as mentioned. And I need to specially mention the UpToDate, which is the best site. And I have taken a lot of references from this UpToDate. The table which we saw of CSF penetrability was also taken from UpToDate. So now we take some questions.
Ma'am, please allow me to share my screen. I have the questions pasted, copy pasted. Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Yeah, is the screen visible?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Now, apart from HIV, are there additional factors influencing the neurological impairment, especially modifiable factors or intervenable factors? So yes, HIV per se causes the infection and all the changes as we discussed. But as we discussed, there are a lot of risk factors. Some of the risk factors are not modifiable, like age, but there are modifiable factors or intervenable factors. So if there are, say, additional vitamin deficiencies like B12 deficiency, that can be treated. If there are metabolic issues, that can be approached. CNS infections. So there has to be thorough evaluation in terms of all these things. So any CNS infection or vitamin deficiency, thiamine deficiency, B12 deficiency, all these things can be addressed. Is there any relationship between CD4 and dementia? As I said, it is shown that CD4 in the risk factor table had shown CD4 less than 200. So low CD4 as a risk with dementia. Definitely there is a relationship. And high viral load, plasma viral load and low CD4 both have a relationship with dementia. How to differentiate depression caused by ART? Now a patient may be having an underlying major depressive disorder, and ART per se may enhance it. For example, drugs like efavirenz. So there can be significant neurotoxicity by some CNS agents like efavirenz. And also now our new drug dolutegravir also can cause some CNS effects, but not to the extent as caused by efavirenz. But we should remember this. And I think whenever it is difficult to differentiate, then we should take a proper opinion by a psychiatrist. A psychiatrist should need to thoroughly evaluate the patient. And in such patients who are having significant psychiatric issues, we should not be giving ART which has neurotoxicity. So in such a patient, definitely we will not be giving efavirenz and other neurotoxic agents. Does the scale in dementia, how much we can relay? I didn't understand this question. The different tests I showed, they are reliable tests for assessing severe dysfunction. But for assessing very mild or asymptomatic dysfunction, then the battery of neuropsychological tests by experts has to be done. But at the bedside, the Montreal test assessment, which I showed you, the Montreal Dementia Scale, can be definitely easily used. Do all depressions need medications, or does counseling play a role? Counseling definitely plays a role, and it is up to the psychiatrist whether, depending on the severity of the depression. If it is just a mild depression and the patient, if the then even counseling and proper talking can be enough. But if it is a major depressive disorder, then definitely medications need to be prescribed. Why still tenofovir in the first line of treatment, even though it has poor CSF penetration? Okay, now when we give any line of drugs, the ART, when we are deciding, exclusive CSF penetration is not the only thing which needs to be considered. We have to see the potency of that regimen, the adverse effect profile. So the current regimen, the tenofovir, lamivudine and dolutegravir, which we are going to be the first, which will be the first line regimen soon. This is a, it has a very highly potent regimen. It has very low toxicity profile. Dolutegravir is a very, very safe drug. It has hardly any adverse effects as compared to the efavirenz, which we are using previously. So if there is proper adherence, because of hardly any side effects, if this leads to proper adherence to ART and proper viral load suppression, that then that is a major thing to prevent HIV dementia. So here, not just the CSF penetrability is not important. Again, dolutegravir has a good CSF penetration, so that compensates for the poor penetration of tenofovir. Now, if such a patient, for example, you have a patient of who is already diagnosed case of HIV associated dementia, and now you want to start this patient, say, on ART, because he is an ART near patient, then maybe we can give such a patient zidovudine, lamivudine and dolutegravir in place of tenofovir, because now we want drugs which will have maximum CSF penetration. But CSF penetration need not be the only thing when we are deciding of a regimen for an overall patient. And with proper ART, we are anyway going to prevent HIV associated dementia. So if the patient is going to be adhering to this regimen because of very low side effects, then this is going to be a long way in preventing the dementia. So now anybody wants to ask a question, they can raise their hand. Anybody has a question other than all this?
Participants can unmute themselves and ask questions.
Please ask. Yes, Dr. Parimala. Please unmute your mic and ask. Dr. Parimala had raised the hand. We are not able to hear you. Please unmute your mic and ask.
Madam, just a moment, madam.
Please speak loudly.
Just a moment, madam. Dr. Parimala.
Okay. Okay.
Actually, I could not hear the question at all. Can somebody type the question so that I can I have not heard the question. Okay, there is a question, what is metabolic encephalopathy and its relation to dementia? Metabolic encephalopathy, we have different types of metabolic encephalopathy like uremic encephalopathy seen in chronic CKD. We have hepatic encephalopathy in liver disorders. Then we have thiamine deficiency causing encephalopathy. So these are the different metabolic, hyponatremia, electrolyte disturbances. These are the metabolic encephalopathies. Can we use IFA in this case? From Dr. Pandurang Patil. Yes, efavirenz can be used in a case of HIV associated neurocognitive disorder. But if the patient has some psychiatric symptoms overlapping, then it is better not to use. Okay, there is a question from Dr. Swami. Yes, I had already answered this.
Yeah, all other questions are taken, ma'am.
Thank you everyone for the patient hearing, and thank you once again to iTech.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the session, and thank you to participants for patient listening. Please write back to iTech if you have any questions, or we can end the session now. Thank you, ma'am.